Let's bring in our panel now, political scientist Dr Jennifer Curtin from Auckland University, Sam Johnson, founder of the Volunteer Army and founder of Head of Community at MyCare, and Marianne Elliott, human rights lawyer, co-director of The Workshop, a policy think tank. Good morning to you all. Jennifer, let's just start off with that business confidence issue. Has the government got a real problem here, a political problem? They can't seem to win over business.
Yeah, I think this is an interesting one. It depends what measure. And so clearly business confidence is being measured by these quarterly surveys. We know from conversations with business leaders that they truly didn't anticipate this government being formed. So they were already, you know, a couple of months behind the eight ball. I do wonder how much, you know, they were just expecting National to win and so didn't do the work of a business community in advance of the election. So why would they be surprised about a $20 per hour wage? You know, it's a living wage standard. Why wouldn't they have had those conversations in advance of the election? Why did they assume potentially that National was definitely going to win? Because those are the conversations that business leaders should be having with all parties in advance of an election campaign. Same with the oil and gas. Divestment strategies all around the world mean that, you know, investment in oil and gas is kind of not something that everybody's interested in. France, cities, New York, London, they're all thinking about this. So this element of shock and then ambivalence and grumpiness is, you know, in a way, almost as ideological as what they're accusing Labor.
But the problem is, it can have implications. It can mean that they stop investing and that there's, you know, that the economy weakens. Is that a serious worry, Sam?
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, that was a very good interview by the finance minister. But I think it's unsurprising that business confidence is going down. I mean, it's the second a new government starts playing with the employment laws and labour laws, and there is a lot more clarity that can come out about that. What does triangulation means a very different thing to a construction industry than it does a courier company that's designed their business around that model. I think we, from what Michael Barnett's saying, I would agree there is a lot more clarity that needs to be given so that business confidence does go back up. We need to see that in the next few months. And I think it's not necessarily, I don't think the government should read into it that they disagree with the changes that are being made, but the way that they are happening and the speed of those changes, it doesn't give a whole lot of confidence to the business sector.
Marianne, is it a case though of they're never going to agree and they just need to get over it?
I think they need to, you know, act in a responsible way and make plans for the future, presuming this is the government we've got for the, you know, for the foreseeable future, and ought to have really been able to foresee this. These are not happening. The $20 an hour wage is being signalled for 2021. That's plenty of time for a business to prepare themselves. As somebody who has owned a business in hospitality, which is an area where it's not easy to lift wages, but if you know that's coming,
but business really didn't like that message from Ian Lees Galloway that, you know, if you can't cope, tough luck. That really struck a chord with many of these business leaders. They felt under siege by that.
Well, I mean, that's a little bit sensitive of them. The reality is, you know, these are the settings and within which you need to build a successful business if that's what you've chosen to do. I'm interested in the comment that the Minister of Finance said, that in what he sees, that in small and medium-sized businesses, often the business owners are actually moving more in that direction of higher wages. I wonder, and this is just a question really, is that because of that closer connection to workers? And so you see the impact on people's lives of those small shifts. Certainly that was our experience. I mean, you know that if somebody's working hard in your business to make your business successful and they're not making enough money to rent a home in your city for their family and to be able to get to work safely and home again, that doesn't feel good. That's not satisfying. That's not acceptable as a business owner. So, you know, I think there's a responsibility on business owners, sure, to meet that.
It's a whole new paradigm, though, for business owners under a Labor government. I mean, what's the very significant role of the unions and for business to really see the unions as a social partner and working with the government? And that signal's come out very strong, and I think it's a good signal. But that's a completely new paradigm from the last 9 years. So business is unsure about how to behave, how to interact with the government and see where that goes and what that means for them. What does it mean for them employing new people? As an employer, what do we employ?
employment new people? Is the machinery of government going to keep up with the rate of and pace of change of technology? And as a technology business, that's what we see. We can develop a whole new pieces of kit all the time, but will government be able to keep up with that? And what's the role, and where's that intersection? So there is insecurity, we're unsure about that. It's not necessarily a bad thing, and I think it would be the same if it was the national government in as well. I mean, it is this amazing confrontation of old government machinery with new technology and a new and emerging models of economy.
But ministers do need to show confidence in their communication, don't they? And one of the issues seems to be the communication. Is that an area perhaps where the government could lift their game a little bit?
Yeah, they need to message it better. But I think to assume that it's a universal discontent is problematic. So even in Auckland, we've seen, you know, a new fast food company is going to come in. And just the last week has announced, you know, 12 new businesses. Fletcher's is going to open a new factory in Drury. Uber's talking about thinking as Auckland as being the city where you can have Uber aircraft to get to work. I mean, there are people still wanting to invest in Auckland and in New Zealand. So to assume that this business, you know, the lack of confidence is a universal lack of confidence is problematic. But by the same token, you know, the responsibility is on government to keep going with their messages and to reassure business. At some point, somebody's going to have to blink, something's got to give, because the narrative coming out of the business community isn't necessarily going to help our international reputation either, in terms of what messaging our investors overseas going to get if the local business community is constantly on
and
a downer.
And who do you think's going to blink?
I have no idea.
On the issue, just quickly before we go to the break, the issue of the tariffs and how New Zealand might respond. We're seeing this trade war. What do you think New Zealand can do here? I mean, we can't do anything substantive, but we could make a point, couldn't we?
I think we've got to be careful making a point. We're a small player in that, and it affects our agriculture business in such a huge way. From a farming background, what does it mean for us exporting wheat and barley? And what's going to happen with that? So I think we've got to be very careful. But I would like to see more commentary of the government on the issues that are affecting us. I think we have been a bit quiet recently. So we've got to tread carefully, but I still think it's a Labor government. There's strong opinions. We've got a very courageous Prime Minister. Let's see those opinions coming out.
Jennifer, you've just been in Europe.
I have.
What's the sense there? Because we're just seeing Trump whacking another, well, talking of another tariff. He's doubling down. It's all go.
It is. I think there is nervousness generally, but I don't think New Zealand are the only country to be wanting to tread softly and not to raise the ire of the current US president. So we know that even the OECD is playing it gently. So there's a reasoning behind this in terms of not wanting to enhance the rage that he has in the area of tariffs. But certainly nobody really wants trade wars. So Europe is nervous. It's one of those things where you just have to take it carefully, I think.
Marianne, you were saying earlier on to me that you think there's a bit of psychology here and that there's a reluctance to inflame Trump, because then that he can then point to people attacking his country, the whole America First thing.
Well, part of his narrative that he's, you know, saying to his base is that we have to protect America against a world, and it's us against them. So there must be a sense, I'm imagining, amongst global leaders, that if they come back hard against Trump, it just inflames that sense amongst his base that they ought to be retaliating. So it's not just that he loses his cool and retaliates. It actually also really enforces that story that he's selling to his base. And I think that's a tough line.
It's a bit of a no-win situation. Yeah.